Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the new CSIS building. If you have not had an opportunity to visit us here at 1616 Rhode Island Avenue, my name is Heather Conley. I'm Senior Fellow and Director of the Europe Program here at CSIS. And as I welcome the minister to the building this morning, I said, you are my grand opening for CSIS to have a visiting minister with us. And we could not be more delighted and could not say in a more timely way to invite Dr. Juozas Olekas, the Minister of National Defense of Lithuania, to be with us. Arriving last night, I think fresh from Brussels, from the NATO Defense Ministerial meeting, we are delighted that Dr. Olekas will be with us and help shape so many key issues that are going on in the region. We'll go from the future of NATO to regional issues to Afghanistan. This is what I love about the transatlantic relationship. We truly span the globe, and we're delighted that our Lithuanian partners help us with all these important issues. We have an hour for conversation and discussion. I'm just going to briefly introduce the minister and then turn this over for some opening remarks. And then, Mr. Minister, we have, and this is a credit to the wonderful audiences that come to CSIS, we have ambassadors, Ambassador Mann from Germany, Ambassador Ball from Sweden, our Ambassador Paro from Croatia. We have the diplomatic community, experts, military officers. They're coming to hear you. And so we're excited that...
Too much.
We're excited that you are with us. There aren't too many defense ministers that we have a doctor in the house, also served twice as Minister of Health of Lithuania. But also served twice as defense minister. So this is your second turn here, and we are delighted. I've been a leader in the Lithuanian parliament as well as the parliamentary assembly for the NATO parliamentary assembly, the European Council parliament assembly. So you are a parliamentarian extraordinaire. So you have the beat on where so many European voters are viewing things. So with that, I kindly turn the floor over to you, Mr. Minister. Welcome to CSIS. Colleagues, welcome. And we look forward to your remarks. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I would like to congratulate you with this new building and the new community. And indeed, we just have a meeting 2 days ago in the Brussels, NATO Defense Ministerial. And it was a long discussion about the situation, about the coming future, and we're looking forward for the NATO summit next year, and what is will happen in Afghanistan when we little bit closing the our activities and then shortening the activities in Afghanistan and looking for the future communication between the NATO members, keeping the achieved results and interoperability between the different nations, different militaries, and looking forward for some initiatives for the future. And if I may start with mentioning that there in Lithuania, there's a long life story about the advertisement in the newspaper saying the proposal for exchange, I'm trading my independence for a security geographical location. And this is very important in our Baltic region. And it's not only, you can say, joke, but during the period between the two world wars, one of our prominent political philosophers, Pakštas, has proposed a very seriously to the government of Lithuania to consider buying an island close to the Africa's shores. He was sure that Lithuanians would never be secure and finally will face the extinction. And this was true for some time after the Soviet occupation. But you know, the reality is what is, and we can change it, and we cannot choose our neighbors, And really smart is the one of manage to survive and thrive in the given situation. Our Baltic states have always been between the best and east. And from one side, this is the big challenge, as it means constraint, uncertainty, and instability. And from other side, this is maybe a possible serving a bridge using the those two entities. And I remember when we discussed in our independence movements in the 90s that it's a good opportunity to us to join these two entities. But life is going and we have different situations. Sometimes we succeed, sometimes we have the problems. And so how should one live in such uncertainty and instability? Actually, there is nothing new I can tell. We are basing our security on three main pillars. The strong and capable NATO with strong transatlantic link. By strong, I mean that we have to be able to take decision in NATO. By capable, I mean that we have to be able to implement those decisions. And second one is the united Europe. By united, I mean not so much our economical or social integration. We have to be able to speak on one voice, to have one voice on defense and policy matters. However, we are not so close to this. Stable and cooperative Eastern Partnership. So we would have real partners, not rivals, in the East. And what is the glue uniting this all three pillars? There's anything common between them. I believe that common thing is that everything is achievable if there's a mutual trust and respect. To put it on other words, if there's a collective thinking. If we would achieve it, all three pillars would be fine and we would be able to solve any existing challenges and problems. Unfortunately, today we are witnessing many cracks. Iraq, Libya, especially Syria events have shown that we are not able to act together. And it is not only America and Europe, but cannot find the common goal grounds. European unity is cracking as well. We can witness hostility between the periphery and big central states. Claims that all members are deprived of the workplace, sovereignty, and others. There are also the problems related to nationalism have always been present in Europe. The US participation and footprints has brought stability in Europe and pushed it towards in the integration process. However, current economical crisis has brought extreme thinking back. We can hear a voice calling for disintegration of EU, withdrawal of US missiles from Europe and similar. And Europe is not stable, and I am convinced that US presence in Europe is still very much needed and extremely important. So why there is no unity and what can be done to review the spirit of collectivism? I believe unity can be achieved through the common actions. That is why understanding the importance of collective thinking Lithuania first, from the very beginning, has joined operation in Iraq, in Afghanistan, and other places, and supported the decision on Syria. Second, Lithuania has joined project like AGS, C-17, missile defense and the like, which make the allies to act together. Another excellent example of so-called smart defense is in our region is NATO air police mission over the Baltic states. We do all have to understand that our future lies on our abilities to act together, to understand that NATO air police mission not only the Baltic states, but of the whole alliances guards the borders of NATO and EU. Third, we are strong proponents of exercises. And it is not only because of our security concern. I would very much subscribe to George Friedman, who has written about the nostalgia of old NATO, when everybody was planning and exercising together, when you knew and understood each other around the table. Thus, there is no surprise we are very much interested in NATO, having large scale of division size exercise every year. And some say that we should listen to the logics of economy, which is not in the best shape now. However, I am convinced that first of all, we should listen to the logic of our values. And this is main important. Fourth, we are making all the possible nets of cooperation, seeking security through the interdependence. We started with the so-called Bal Dream project, where all three Baltic states have put their efforts together, creating capabilities we would never be able to have separately. So we have the Baltnet, Baltron, Baldevkol, Balbat, and others project. You can ask, is it easy? No, it's not. Sometimes we do also face some challenges emerging from selfish interests. However, we do see the value and importance of such cooperation, and we are willing to overcome obstacles on our ways. Similarly, we are engaging more and more with the Nordic countries, expanding our cooperation and to common project, for example, thinking of one united exercise plan in the region that would allow streamlining our efforts to the best result possible. Nordic and Baltic states are among our most active partners in operations, and we plan to cooperate in the field as well. I mentioned our situation in the Afghanistan, where we're looking for the North Afghanistan and Mazar Sharif, not only Baltic, Nordic, Croatia, and other Balkan countries on the leadership of Germany. And we had a very good discussion 2 days ago in the Brussels on the Frame Nation group discussing about the future of that. And also our cooperation goes behind defense and security issue. We do a lot together on energy security. Together with our Denmark colleagues, we are working a lot on energy proficiency in military and green energy issues. And there are many other projects in the future. And finally, if I may, we are building cooperation with our Eastern partners. Together with Poland, we try to engage the Ukraine. I do hope our joint project, lead Paul Lugubrik, will be given a go. We do work very close with Georgia, Moldova, and other countries. We have a very good involvement with these countries in Afghanistan project and in Gor province PRT project. And both of us Eastern partners have to pay the price for this. You know, the pressure from our neighbors is very, very strong one, and what is happens with Albania. And you can hear the President Putin position for Ukraine in some situation. And if to sum up, I am convinced that mutual trust and respect comes through the very concrete projects. And these projects not only allow us to achieve a certain degree of interoperability, create real capabilities, but is more important, acting to shoulder helps us to come to collective thinking as it was during the Cold War. This will be a mutual trust and understanding. We will be able to solve these problems ahead of us. Thank you.
Sure, I'm here. Mr. Minister, thank you so much. That was a wonderful tour de force of where you're thinking these days and focusing. Now is the time for us to join the conversation. I just remind colleagues, this is an on-the-record discussion. I'm going to let you have a few moments to collect your questions, and I'm going to, if it's all right with you, Mr. Minister, ask a few questions, and then we'll turn this over to you. If you could just raise your hand and then identify yourself and your affiliation, that would be, I could give you one of my pens, too. That would be terrific. Thank you. I want to begin a bit with looking ahead. Next year's NATO summit, and of course, part of the conversation at the Defense Ministerial was thinking, I'm sure, about that agenda, and that's really NATO's next chapter. And so I'd like your thoughts on if you today could create that agenda for next October, what would the key elements be on that? And then I'd like to follow on with that question about Afghanistan. Lithuania has been very forward-leaning in its commitment to a post-2014 presence, but clearly there are outstanding questions about the negotiations between the U.S. and Afghanistan on a post-force and transition. How much will your decision be based on whether the United States can negotiate an agreement with the Afghan government following post-2014? I'll start there. I have one other question, and then I'll unleash the audience on you.
Okay.
Please.
Yeah, if I may, it's a very important job for me, and it's very difficult to predict what will be the future. But anyway, on the base of this knowledge that I have now and what we discussed 2 days ago in the Brussels, I think that is the main goal for the coming summit is to summarize the situation in Afghanistan. Because it was one of the biggest, or maybe say the biggest operation or mission of NATO allies, and it's there are different point of view. You can hear the criticism from President Karzai sometimes, and others, pessimist, and it's very important that we should have a common view on what we achieved. I think that we achieved a lot in this 10-year period. We had a stable Afghanistan and increased the possibilities for the country. I have been in Afghanistan 11 times, I think.
11?
Visiting our troops and in about 8-year period. And I can assure you that it's a huge difference what I have seen in 8 years ago in Kabul and in the countryside in the Gor province and in the south. And what we left now, it's new buildings, new infrastructure, more smiling people, the more school boys and girls in the school, the new facilities in the hospitals. And this is one that what we should do in this coming summit to summarize, and maybe also have a vision for the future. I hope that till this time we will have the United States and Afghanistan will be signed the agreement, and NATO and Afghanistan will be signed, and we will have the new president, and we can hear the new vision of the new president of Afghanistan in the summit too. The second one is what we should do for the future when we cutting our activities in Afghanistan as a mission and operation. And we have also here the view that it's the possibility to have large exercises regular in different region going around the NATO, and having this our interoperability and capabilities, what we reach in this 10 years period on the same level. Mm-hmm. And last but not least, I think we should avoid the discussion on the enlargement.
Avoid?
We should not avoid.
Should not avoid. Avoid. I want to make sure about that. Should not avoid
the enlargement, because two summits, one after another, will be with the announcing that the door is open. Mm-hmm. And we cannot to close after this the summit the doors, because some countries is ready, or they thinking that they is ready. We should evaluate the situation, and I can count some of them: the Montenegro, the Georgia. They are in different position, but it's very important to us to keep this door open and to discuss with our partners, because they do a lot together with us in different mission. For example, in Afghanistan, the Georgia is the biggest contributor out of NATO members in this place.
Ms. Mercer, thank you so much. I'd like to turn a little bit more to regional security, and would be grateful for your thoughts on the recent Russian military exercise, APAD 2013, that concluded last month. Your reflections on it. Obviously, we're in an open setting, but your impressions of that, what that meant for Lithuanian security interests, and then your thoughts on next month's operation, the exercise. Speaking of exercises, Steadfast mm-hmm. Jazz. You noted in your opening remarks how important the U.S. presence was in Europe. Some of the ghosts of European nationalism are returning, but yet the U.S. Participation in Steadfast Jazz is considerably smaller than had been anticipated. So I would welcome your thoughts on Zapad and also Steadfast Jazz, and what this means for Lithuania and Lithuanians. How are they viewing these two exercises?
Thank you very much. It means the Zapad. When you hear something from Russians, and Minister Sergei Shoigu, he participated in the NATO-Russia Council, and he explained that it was the anti-terroristic exercises, but we joking between ourselves why they not declare or announce that this anti-terrorist 2013. Yeah. But they decided to name them the Zapad 2013. This means something different. And if we compare the Zapad and Steadfast Jazz, in Steadfast Jazz it will be participate about 16 nations and 6,000 soldiers. In this Zapad 2013, in anti-terroristic exercises, participate more than 40,000 soldiers, air and marine in the Baltic, in the North Sea, and for the managing the terrorists that some actions in some way in the Belarus and Kaliningrad. That's little bit difference, and maybe the military, they can explain how we need so much soldiers in this anti-terroristic training and not so much in the Steadfast Jazz exercise. But on the other hand, this means that Russia or the Russia and Belarus, they say this joint exercises, they have some new approach, and they try to modernize the army and control and other things in Russian and Belarusian armed forces, and they concentrate this all achievements and all main goal in this Zapad region or West region, and this creates some thinking for it that we should be ready for something if something happens, because the one of the possible project is they call the blockade Kaliningrad. And this means that to occupy Lithuania or part of Lithuania. Because the corridor between the Belarus and Kaliningrad goes through the Lithuania or Lithuania and Poland. This is not only the our problem, but I think that we should be ready, and we think and act that this our joint or collective defense is very, very important for all of us. And steadfast is the exercise for NRF, and also on the article number 5, but we're looking forward for the future since 2015 and further to have the regular regional our exercises to keep our level of our interoperability and capabilities in the same level that we achieve now, or maybe improve it a little bit in the future, to having a better relation with our neighbors.
Wonderful. All right, I gave you some time to think through your questions, and I see Ian Brzezinski is hands up first. Ian.
Thank you, Minister.
There's a microphone right behind you there. Sorry.
Thank you, Mr. Minister, for sharing your time with us, and Heather, thank you for hosting. This is a wonderful facility. One comment and one question. Comment would be, is that I hope you and your colleagues in Lithuania will bring to NATO the same approach that your governments brought to your chairmanship of the EU, that Poland brought to the chairmanship of the EU, in terms of leveraging the summit, the NATO summit, to enhance awareness and appreciation over the coming year for the alliance. I just throw that out as a thought, because I think it's a great hook to reanimate what I think has been declining awareness and appreciation on both sides of the Atlantic for the alliance. The question I wanted to put to you is a little bit more technical. You mentioned it. You were at the ministerial in Brussels 2 days ago, and one of the ideas that were rolled out for the NATO summit was this concept of framework nations. And I'd be interested in what you think of it. I'm skeptical. I think it could be fragmentary in the alliance. I think it could dissipate capability. And I think it rests on an assumption, a weak assumption of common views in the alliance, of consensus, an exaggerated sense of consensus in the alliance. Because if the framework concept is going to work and be operationalized, pretty much everyone in a framework capability set is going to have to be in agreement to go into an operation. One of the nice things about NATO is that it does create coalitions of the willing. Fragmentary NATO framework nations, I think, will be less capable of doing that. I'd be interested in your reactions.
Thank you very much for your comment and for your question. Indeed, we not very enthusiastic support this new initiative. I said that we support, but we should look what this means. Is it means that there are some possibilities to create the joint or grouping for some practical action? As for example, I mentioned the north of Afghanistan. If we create this framework nation as a for the special operation in special place and in special time, it's maybe there have been there some positive steps. And now we're discussing between ourselves, Baltics, Nordics, and some Balkans countries together with the German leadership to have some kind of the future mission in the north of Afghanistan. And we should compare this new initiative, because it is not yet enough discussed. What is it? We have the Smart Defense Initiative, how we are pooling and sharing. And also we have the NATO planning and preparing to be in the quiet level for our action. But it's not the final decision, or not the decision themselves, but we should discuss this initiative where we have found the positive steps. On the other hand, as I mentioned, we should keep in mind that our joint NATO planning, contingency planning, and also to sovereignty of the states, how they are ready to be on defense issue and not postpone something in the framework, and to split the all alliance for some framework nation. So this is the open question for us. It was not strongly supported in this our summit. It was the discussion that yes, this is the new initiative from the German side, and this proposal should be discussed, and we will see what may be happened in the future.
Thank you, Heather, and thank you, Minister, for a very interesting exposé. The Swedish ambassador recently arrived here, and I have to say I experienced a very considerable interest in Nordic-Baltic cooperation from the United States right now. And with President Ilves, one could perhaps even talk about a certain mini-pivot to the Baltics. These days we had the three presidents visiting the President of the United States in August, and we had President Obama in Stockholm just a few weeks later on, where he also met with the Nordic leaders. So we are very pleased to see this interest in that region, and of course regional cooperation is of key importance to us, and I'd like to echo what the Minister said about the scope and importance of regional cooperation in the Baltic area between the Nordics and the Balts, and also other countries around the Baltic area. And there's quite a lot to talk about. We have, since a very long time, the Baltic countries engaged with the Nordic Defense Cooperation, the NODEFCO cooperation. There are regular meetings of Nordic Baltic defense ministers, chiefs of defense. We have the joint exercise plan that you mentioned, Mr. Minister. We have issues such as the cooperation within the framework of the European Union battle groups. The Nordic battle group in 2015 will be a largely Nordic-Baltic battle group, also with participation of Ireland. So that's a very positive thing. We have the Baltic Defense College, where we do joint courses. We have the Nordic Baltic Initiative, which is primarily geared towards providing training in defense and security sector reform in countries such as Ukraine, Moldova, Georgia, something we do together there as well. So it's there's a lot to talk about as far as progress in our joint security cooperation. Of course, more could be done, and I would be putting the simple question to you, Mr. Minister: what would you like to see happen in the Nordic-Baltic cooperation in the years to come? Thank you very much.
If I may?
No, please. Oh, yes.
Okay. thank you very much for your comments and mentioning that this project, which I did not mention in my introductory speech. Indeed, we are very satisfied with our activities, and we would like to continue on the same level. We agreed between the Baltic defense ministers to a little bit change our framework to be closer to the Nordic one, and to strengthen this our possibilities to be together with you. What can be done in the future? I think we can be more together in the same coming project. For example, we start to send our trainers to Mali together, Baltics and Nordics. We participate in some countries, but we call that use the same name, and we're looking forward for the next year's exercise planning. we can be more close and we organize more, not duplicate the national and regional exercises, and we will be happy to have the perspective planning for maybe 5 or 10 years, in including in them the NATO plannings, the regional plannings and national plannings, to save the resources and to create the better effective view of use these resources and being together. And, we're looking forward for very very practical examples. For you mentioned in Baltic call, we're looking about the possibilities to increase the level, to go to the Baltic Defense University or Baltic Nordic cooperation training for our staff. I think it's the vision what we can do more together in the future.
Mr. Minister, just let me start by saying that the struggle, your struggle for independence, is well remembered in Germany, and there's a lot of admiration, not only in the government but also in the people at large. I've been here now for 2 years, and I could sum up my experience in Washington by an old Bob Dylan song: "The times are changing, oh." And they are changing quite quickly. So I have two questions from that. First, how can we, in these changing times, ensure that the Americans, that the U.S. still has an interest in Europe? It's a very general question, but I think it's the core of it all. And the second question, of course, is, as technology is changing, as military technology is changing, as in parallel the resources we can muster are more and more limited. We have a crisis in Europe, so and you have problems here too with budgets, and so how can we arrange? How can we become effective as NATO, or stay effective? And of course, we have to. You mentioned a few concepts: pooling and sharing. And on the other side, if NATO shall have a role out beyond Article 5, then we have a problem that. If we divide our resources country by country, then we have to be sure that we can make use of these resources. And so we need a concept, and maybe you could share some thoughts how you could imagine such a division of labor in future.
Thank you. it's not easy, I think, to answer both questions that you mentioned. But first of all, the answer for the first, what is the interest of U.S. to in Europe? I think the same values. If we are on the basis of same values, we should be together to fight for these values and be ready to fight if it will be needed. The new isolationism, you know, isolation of countries is nothing for the future. For maybe a short time, you can reach something, achieve something, but if you're looking for the future, the global voice is coming closer and closer. The events in different parts of the world is very, you've been involved in every region, despite the Europe or US, and only one way, to being on the same values, to act as a same family or same club of countries, to having in mind the same values. And I think that our links between the Europe and United States it's very important. Yes, we hear that United States have the interest in Asia, and this is our interest also, because the changes in Asia is this very important for Europe too, and U.S. should allocate additional focus on these changes in this part of the world. But it's, from my point of view, it's not to mean that U.S. left Europe alone. This is the maybe kind of timely priorities for this time. But our the same the joint values, I think it's very important to be together. And from our discussion in the NATO ministerial in the Brussels, I think that we still will keep this the same interest and need for to be as one family. For the resources, military technology, and how we can effectively use that, of course, I think we should calculate what we can allocate for the military. It's our goal that we should share all countries, not only depend on the United States resources in Europe. My country also should we should increase the financial resources for our military forces, and this is one of our goal. We lost a lot in this economical crisis period. For 4 years, one third of resources which was allocated to the for the military needs, it was cut. But now we have agreement between the all political parties in the parliament, inside the government, that we should go step by step to increasing and go to close to the 2% for the future. And this is what we need. And of course, this is collective approach, and looking what we should have in all countries, in all us in allies, not only to getting the new technology and then changing the new things. It's, everything is going very rapidly, and we should be careful not to lose so much, because the new technology is developing very, very rapid, and this create the needs for resources for a huge amount. And we should, I think, very open, discussed and planning, do the joint planning process, how we can build interoperable capacities between all members of NATO and save in this kind of money. And there are some examples. For example, ways that how we can go. We have the idea of this new centers of excellency. For example, in Estonia and Tallinn, we have the NATO Center of Excellence on Cyber Defense. Now we create and open in Lithuania and Vilnius the energy, same security, and we have a lot to discuss this issue, because the military or armed forces is the biggest consumer for energy. And if we can succeed with the cutting or more effective use the energy resources in military forces, we have possibilities to use these resources for other needs that we need, for the modernization of military forces, for more effective. And some initiatives, for example, the Danish initiative about the green energy, why not it use in the military? And we can save some resources and also create a better climate environment. This is also very important. There are a lot of possibilities to working together, and including the research and other activities, to save the resources and allocate this more for what is needed in the practical way.
If I may, why don't we bundle a few questions, and then, Mr. Minister, I'll let you respond to them. So we have Mike Holtzel, I know, Ambassador Keith Smith, there is anybody else that, and one in the back. So we'll start with Ambassador Smith, we'll go to Mike, and then our colleague in the back.
Thank you. The Swedish ambassador took some of my questions, but I have two questions. One regarding Ukraine. I just came back from Ukraine, and the question is, how much cooperation is continuing on the military sphere between Lithuania? I know Poland and Ukraine is continuing, but I don't know what Lithuania is doing. The second has to do with the question of U.S. continuing U.S. Presence in Europe, and there's a lot of talk in Europe about the pivoting of the U.S. away from Europe. But I spent a lot of time in the Baltic states in two different countries, and the one thing I, at least at that point, was there was very little interest in the Baltic states west of the Polish border. And my question is, has that really changed dramatically? I know that they had their own issues to deal with, but except for Sweden and the U.K., it was very difficult to get European NATO members to give concrete help to the new militaries in the Baltic states. Has that changed? Mm-hmm. Sorry to be controversial, but I'd like to put that question.
We like controversy and provocative questions. Why don't we have the microphone right behind you, Mike?
Thank you. I'm Mike Holtzel from the Center for Transatlantic Relations at Johns Hopkins University. Welcome and thank you also, Heather. I'd like to get back to two issues we've already discussed. Popular support for the alliance, which I think everyone agrees is flagging. I don't think there's a magic answer. We don't have the same kind of glaring threat that we had during the Cold War. And nonetheless, there certainly are behaviors. You've alluded to them, pressure on the Eastern Partnership. We'll see that at the summit. In Vilnius, Zapad, as you talked about, even air incursions. I'm not trying to stir up alarm in the alliance, but I do think a public education campaign in all our countries would be a good idea. And I think that the question of capabilities is still there. I couldn't agree with you more, Mr. Minister, that we have to cooperate better, we have to have smart defense, all these things. Nonetheless, when most of the alliance members are spending under the 2% for the military, it's very hard to streamline and cut and be smarter and continue on that path. One word about the framework concept. Ironically, here you may have a conflict with what I just said is a goal of getting popular support. And Ambassador Amman can correct me if I'm wrong, but as I understand the framework concept, for example, for a mission that Germany would lead, it would have to be approved by the Bundestag, which is fine, that's a democratic idea, but it's problematic in many ways, as would approval by the U.S. Congress be, for example. So, I mean, I think we have contrasting things. One final quick question. When you mentioned enlargement, I thought it was striking that you didn't mention Macedonia, which in fact was approved at the Bucharest summit, and now we're into almost the second decade of what a lot of people think is sort of a silly name issue. I understand the consensus principle in the alliance, but is there no way to be blunt, to exert pressure on both parties for the greater good of the alliance, for the greater good of the EU, for heaven's sake, to get this thing settled so that we can have, I'm not an agent for Macedonia, but they've contributed the same way Georgia has. Everybody knows this. So these are the two questions, the capabilities, public education, and the enlargement. Thank you.
Great. We have one question right in the back. Oh, right there.
Good morning, Mr. Minister. I'm Patu Kutelia. I represent McCain Institute. Thank for your very strong support for my country during your today's speech and in generally Lithuanian support to Georgia. I'm from Georgia. You spoke about integrational processes in Europe, whether it's European Union or NATO. And we've seen throughout the history that in most of the time, in the changing dynamic periods of European continent, the integrational processes were the answer. In 20th century, there was an integration process under the Soviet ideology, countered by the integration process under the freedom of the and free society. Today we face the same two contradictory integrational processes. One is the enlargement of the democracies, European Union, NATO. On the other hand, we have Eurasian Union, attempt of resurrection of the Soviet Union. So my question is how optimistic you are about us being proactive rather than reactive towards the Russia-led integrational process. Thank you.
You get to choose what you'd like to answer in the next 5 minutes.
Just 5 minutes? Okay, I will just run through it. Regarding the Ukraine, I think we still continue and everything will be more clear after the European summit in November in Vilnius. Or Ukraine will be ready and sign this agreement. I know that former President Kwasniewski and Mr. Cox, they are working very actively in Ukraine, trying to reach this agreement. It will be for both sides, for European Union and for Ukraine, acceptable. And I still optimistic. We work together with Poland to create the Lithuanian, Poland, and Ukraine brigade. And this is also going on. I have the possibility to meet the Minister of Defense of Ukraine in the Brussels. We discussed, and we still quite optimistic to end this project this year. U.S. and Europe and support in more west to the borders of Poland. I think there are some changes. I think we have the new formats. We're working very closely with the United Kingdom on the battle groups, European Union battle groups, and we working together with the Swedish, Netherlands, Lithuania, Latvia, and UK, and we found more and more common approaches in different areas on defense security sector. And I hope that this will lead a good hope for the future. For the public support, I fully agree with you. I think it's one of them, the most important to have public support for the defense and security issue, to reach the goals and to reach the support on resources in countries and in the parliaments. And the Macedonia is just, because I not mentioned every experienced countries, I think it is the very sad that one country can block just for the name, the other country do not take part in the disintegration process, and I hope that we all together would found the possible way to reach to found a way how we can manage with this problem and to open the door and to have the more stable and more wider our allies. Russia active or proactive? I think that every country have to possibilities to decide what it wants, but not every one country have the possibilities to block the decision of other countries, and this should be the our main position. That Russia didn't have the veto for the U.S. For the EU enlargement or for the NATO enlargement. This is our position.
Very well. You did very well. Those were very tough questions in a very short period of time. Well, as Ambassador Mann mentioned, Bob Dylan's times there are changing. Now, I credit this to Ambassador Bob Hunter, but he said this is more like the Beatles, with NATO being 64 years old. Will you still need me? Will you still feed me when I'm 64? maybe that's another tune we should hum as we think about getting towards next year's NATO summit. Mr. Minister, you have offered us an enormous offering, a buffet of ideas and important issues, framework nation concept, Afghanistan, enlargement. You've talked about regional cooperation, raising Nordic-Baltic cooperation to a new level, and using that experience for the Eastern Partnership countries. So you've given us great food for thought, more things for CSIS to work on. Thank you for giving me my to-do list. So I thank you for making time to share your thoughts with us, and I thank my colleagues that we don't have stimulating conversations without really great questions, and so I thank you as well for participating in this discussion. I hope you'll come back and visit us in our new building again.
If you invite.
I would love that, and thank you again, Mr. Minister. Thank you all for joining us, and please thank the Minister for being here today.
Thank you. On my side, I would like to thank you for inviting me.
And get a gift.
And I would like to leave this is a small book about our activities in the Afghanistan, the Ghor province.
Fantastic.
Thanks for everybody who participate and who support us
Mr.
in this
Minister,
mission.
Thank you so
thank
much.
You
thank you all. This is wonderful.